How's it
Hey,
going?
good. How you doing?
I'm pretty good. Wow. Is that your studio?
Yeah. Well, yeah. Just a little home studio down here just messing around. Sorry. I got something in my eye.
No worries.
How you doing?
I'm good. Yeah, I'm sitting on the couch right now. My dog is here. So if there's any barking or snoring or anything, it's just her.
That's awesome. Yeah, same. A tree like blew down, landed on our roof last night. So we got the tree guys here. So if you hear a loud chainsaw every now and then, quietest place I could be, but yeah.
Terrible. Did it cause a lot of damage or?
I don't think too much. Luckily, it hit another tree and they all just kind of sat on the roof. So we just had to have a guy come out and spend like 2 hours just chainsawing like crazy.
Yikes. And are you guys, you're in the new house now, right?
Yeah, we're in the new house. So finally got a chance to kind of set up the studio and get it close to where we want it. But yeah, it's just been crazy.
Yeah, I guess you guys kind of moved in and then didn't really have a lot of time to settle in, but now you do.
Yeah, absolutely. It's been good, though.
Yeah, your studio looks cool. Have you been writing a lot with this time at home?
Yeah, a little bit. It's kind of hard to be inspired right now, a little bit, to be honest. But me and Megan, we wrote 2 songs so far, me and her. I've written a couple by myself. I'm doing more like rock stuff right now, just for fun. I don't know. That's kind of the headspace I'm in. So,
yeah. Hey, you can do whatever you want right now.
But yeah, but we've already started cutting for our record. So we're pretty much done with that. So right now I'm just, yeah, going back to the old days.
Nice. So I have to ask, cause the video, I think I've watched it like 30 times, that you posted of the squirrel in your garbage can.
Oh God, yeah.
How did you know it was in there?
Well, yeah. So like that's the house we're moving out of into this one. So like the yard hasn't been cut, like it's sold. So I was just trying to grab the last stuff. And I heard something rumbling around in there and I saw like its eyes were looking out that little hole. And so I knew it was there, but I was just like, I know how jumpy I am. I was just going to send it to Megan as a joke. But when it jumped out, it really, that scream really was real. I don't know what it was.
I almost screamed. It looked like, I mean, you see squirrels like jumping from tree to tree outside.
Yeah. And
it literally did that like across the lawn.
It was hilarious. But yeah, it scared me a little bit.
So are you afraid of just like things jumping out at you or?
I'm just afraid. Yeah, Megan does it all the time too. She'll like come around the corner and try. I just like sudden jumps. And honestly, I tell him like, don't do that. I might accidentally like karate chop. Like, I don't know. Like, it's just my senses like.
Yeah.
Being like in movies too, like suspense, like long drawn out tones and then a big plosive noise. Like I'm always freaked out.
The exact same way. I can't do the jumpy stuff, except I'm not a karate chop in response. My knees buckle and I just fall. So I'm the girl that dies first in the horror movie.
Mine sure. Might be the same too.
So you guys were out on the road and then you actually flew to London, was it, for C2C?
Yeah, flew to London, landed, got back in the plane and flew back.
Gosh, what was that experience like? Cause I mean, I feel like just being at home and knowing it's happening out in the world is scary enough, but you were in it. Like you flew during the time and then had to come back after that. What was that like for you?
Yeah, we didn't want to miss out. It was our chance to go play overseas and in UK and everywhere that we've never been, and in Australia we've never been. And so we landed in Atlanta from Nashville, and we heard when that the president was going to maybe tonight say something, but we didn't. There was no confirmation of that at all, so we weren't going to cancel just on word of mouth. And so we got on the plane, and an hour into the flight to London, our phones start blowing up, and my mom's calling, freaking out. Everyone's just freaking. It was the craziest experience on the plane. Like, just these whispers start happening, and then all of a sudden, your phone's blowing up. Hey, travel ban. You can't. And everyone's freaking out because we're like, are we going to be able to get home now?
Yeah.
And so we quickly bought plane tickets on the plane to land. So we landed in London, had to check our bag or get all our bags, walk back to a different airline. We stepped outside in London for like 5 minutes, took in the air, and then checked our bags and got back out on a flight and headed home. Luckily they let us come back, but it was chaos. When we were in London, it was Jordan Davis's crew, Luke Holmes, Cadillac 3, everyone was coming home. And I guess that was the most important thing at that time. So let's get home safe and lock down.
Man, what a crazy time. I mean, obviously better safe than sorry and to get home and everything like that. But yeah, definitely got to be a little bit disheartening and also kind of scary too, being on the plane and hearing that happen and you have no choice. Like you've got to fly there to come back.
Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, this is just a weird time. It's just, I've never expected anything like this. And yeah, we knew the risks of being on the plane, but we didn't, no one knew how serious this was.
It, yeah. You
know, especially at that time, it was just kind of, oh, it's still the flu. It's just the flu. It's nothing worse. And, you know, we're all, well, we can handle the flu to go play for Australia. We didn't know how bad this was and how real it was. And,
right.
So, anyway, luckily everybody's fine. No one got sick through that.
Good.
Of our crew and everybody. So, we're good.
That's good. What are you guys kind of doing at home, you and Meg and obviously the dogs, to stay, yeah, stay busy and sane, other than obviously working on some rock music?
Yeah. Well, we've written a few songs together, like I said, and just getting house projects done. Just working in the backyard. That's pretty much it. Cleaning a lot. She's teaching me a little bit about cooking. She's she's an incredible cook. I'm terrible. So trying to learn there as we can. And then it's turkey season down here. So I'm going hunting a little bit. It's social distancing at its best. Get out in the woods and don't see anybody. So
I was just going to say, that's like the perfect way to social distance. You're very far away from everybody. Is Meg going with you turkey hunting?
She will sometimes. But she's been working a lot, doing a lot of writes, Zoom writes, like this.
So you released Can't Go to Church in January, I think it was.
That sounds right. My whole month, everything's ready to go.
Like, when was that? You kind of gave a little backstory on your own socials about the song, that it was, written from like a true place of when you were younger, you broke up with a girl and you felt like you couldn't go to church anymore. Have you had a lot? I feel like that feeling is probably so universal. Have you had a lot of people reach out about how?
It's been an amazing, like, Jump Me did that for us. And then this song, it's like where relationships have gone in kind of the same path as the song is written, and people reach out. I love that. That's the best feeling in the world. It's the most humbling feeling. I mean, I had those songs. If I had had social media back when I was in high school and I had that song, and if I could text the artist or DM the artist, I would have done it in a heartbeat, because I just wanted to tell them thank you for writing that for me. And I've gotten a few of those, and it's just, that's always just amazing. That's the hope that we have during all this, is we get to go out and play for them again soon when this is all done. And yeah, it's crazy. I mean, those are just, like, to me at the time, that was our social gathering. Now we can go out different places, go to restaurants, bars, and see people. And now you kind of got to change that lifestyle up, where, like, if you break up with someone, you know, that's their bar, you can't go there anymore. But back then, church was pretty much the only place I went outside of school and saw people. So it was like,
right,
I guess I got to change churches or go somewhere else.
And then last thing, I saw you posted this whole like demo challenge has been going around, and you posted Drunk Me. Was it Justin Wilson that sang on it? Which Justin, he has Wilson, a cool voice. How, I know you said that he was going to end up like keeping it or singing it. How did that work that you were like, hey, this is for me, I've got to take this?
Well, see, Justin's just a writer now, so he used to be an artist back in the day, but we were pitching the song, like, people from Blake Shelton to, I don't even, Billy Currington, people had that song.
You kind of cut out there.
Sorry, you got me now?
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah, so, like, that song, we wrote it and we pitched it from, like, Blake Shelton to, like, Billy Currington had that song for a while, and I thought it was one of them was going to cut the song, but it ended up not making their records. And then by the time it came for when I got my record deal and we had to make a record, that song was still available. And I always loved that song. But I was just like, Justin did such a good job singing it. I was like, I don't know if I can beat the demo. And then we got into the studio and we started singing. And I kind of changed up the phrasing and a couple words from the day we wrote it. And I remember coming back in the room and listening to it the first time. I was like, I love this. This is my song. It sounds different. I didn't know if it was good different or bad different, but I knew it sounded different. And I said, if we're going to go with something first, it needs to be unique and sound different. And so that's kind of how that song came about. I always expected someone else to cut it, but it just ended up being one of those things where the stars line up moments. Yeah.
It's crazy how everything happens for a reason. And even listening to the original demo, it's cool to see how you, like, where you made it your own and did your own things. And it's, I think that's an interesting part of, like, the songwriting thing that fans don't get to hear, is like the evolution of a song.
Right. Yeah. And that, even that, they go so much further than that. That's when me and Jordan Schmidt write together, we're like in our studios, and we try to make it close sounding to a record day of. So right. I have songs like on the record that are literally just an acoustic guitar and, you know, maybe a loop or something. And those are always fun to go back to and listen to and see how much it develops when you went into the studio.
Yeah.
Which Drop Me still took on a life of its own, but we did a lot of work that day when we were writing it. So yeah, I love doing that. So the demo challenge has been fun to me because I'm not in the room on my friend's songs a lot of times, like, and so it's cool to hear their demos and then hear their masters. I think it's been a fun kind of challenge to go back and forth on that.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, cool. Well, thanks for doing this, and hopefully
we actually
get to see you in real life soon. As much as this is at least nice for the time being.
Hey, enjoy the break. I believe there's a bigger plan for all of this, and we'll all stay safe and we'll get back out together, but don't take it for granted.
Yeah, definitely.
Thank you.